looking for deep space missions. We need astronauts who can be engineers, who can be doctors, who can be plumbers, who can be cooks. They need to be, one person need to be able to do a lot of things. Because on deep space missions, there's not going to be a plumber to help them fix the toilets if the toilets break. There's no one going to be there to cook food for them. There's no one going to be there to fix any issue that they have with their body, be it their teeth that break or be it their arm that breaks. They will have to be doctors to fix themselves. So these are the kind of skills future astronauts are going to need for deep space missions. So the more they know, the better. They have to be pilots also. That is the reason why I've been training to be a pilot, and being a pilot was always a goal too. It has been, so as a mom, as a working woman, it has been difficult for me to do everything. I have been going at a very slow pace because my family comes first. But I am doing every little thing and I'm enjoying the journey. So that is important. I am sharing and guiding youth like you and younger generation, so that whatever I missed out on, the guidance that I missed out on, I want to share it. So you can apply this up. But still, it will cause some disturbance in the data that is coming. So we call it like phantom data, it's false data. We have, scientists have written algorithms to filter out that kind of data. Why I'm coming to this slide is, after Kepler, TESS is another telescope. What is it? Transit Exo Survey Satellite. Transiting Exo Survey Satellite. It is, Kepler was looking at only one section of the sky, right? TESS is going to look at all the sky, 360 degrees around the Earth, and it is going to look at the stars that are closer to us. Because Kepler gave us planets that are around stars which are hundreds of light years away, and we currently do not have the technology to travel to those stars. But the objective for Kepler was to see if there are planets around stars that are so far out. Now that objective is fulfilled, but now we want to know if there are habitable zone planets around the stars that are really close to us. And that's what TESS is going to do. It is going to look at all the stars that are 5 light years, the closest to us is about 4 light years, right? What is the name of that one?
Alpha Centauri star.
Yeah, the Alpha Centauri. So, that's the one that we know now there is a planet around, but we are not sure if it's in the habitable zone, and we are studying that. But TESS is going to help us do that, find planets, habitable zone planets around stars that are closer to us. And what James Webb is going to do, James Webb Space Telescope, it's going to be further out from where Hubble is even. It's going to be in EO, the middle Earth orbit. And it is going to look at the atmospheres of the planets that are in the habitable zone around stars that are closer to us. It can study, it will be able to study their atmosphere and see if there are traces of water vapor or signs of earthly, habitable gases in the atmosphere, methane, nitrogen, oxygen, and that will help us further narrow down. Oh, okay, this planet has water vapor in its atmosphere. That means it has water, and that means it might have life. So now we cannot just say that, oh, these are habitable zone planets, and so they will happen. No. Science is based on evidence, and that is why we have to take it one step at a time. I know it is really slow, but we are at least doing something, right? Once JWST launches, it is going to be able to tell us, it is going to be able to study the atmospheres, and then maybe in the future, when we have proper propulsion technology, we'll be able to travel to those planets. And that's what brings me to the right point where I'll dive back into my other set of slides to tell you why and where are we going next.